Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be here, and after all the excellent presentations of the morning and this very instructive video, everything has been said, but there's still the need to put things into practice. And the problem is that I am coming from a research institute, and research institutes are not familiar with putting things into practice, but merely they are willing to do research and research and resource. So the Natural Resources Institute Finland, very briefly, I pronounce it LUKE as we say it in Finland. I don't know how you pronounce it in France or Holland or Switzerland, but LUKE is a new institute from the background of agricultural research, forestry research, and game and fisheries research. So Finland's government put three research institutes plus one more into one, which is called now Natural Resources Institute Finland, LUKE. LUKE is a big institute, 1,500 people, 125 million euros spending, several places around Finland. And I am not researcher anymore, so I have 500 people of those, and my most time goes when I try to keep them up and running. But I have a background with this nutrient and organic waste problem, and it's my dear child still. And many of the researchers in my unit are working on that matter. So these are some facts from Finland. So 27 million tons annually. Most of it is animal manure. Significant part of it is grass and straw from the field. But still, one-fourth of it is coming from other sources like industry, bio-waste, municipalities, and so on. Of course, it's very different kinds of things. So fresh tons, very watery, a lot of water in, and variable nutrient and energy contents. These are the examples how they look like. And some statistics about where the phosphorus and nitrogen comes. So most of it is in animal manure, but also these other bio-waste side products, municipal waste and sludges, they are also significant sources of phosphorus and nitrogen in Finland. And most of it is used for agriculture. Unfortunately, a big part of it is used in a little bit wrong places. So especially when it's about manure is normally spread where it's produced. And that's, of course, a question for eutrophication of waters. But actually, it is not about the amount of animals, and it's not about the amount of manure. It's actually about of the amount of feed, which is coming from elsewhere. And when the feed is coming from elsewhere, it means that the nutrients are concentrated into wrong place. Doesn't it sound a little bit like big animal production places are like cities? So cities are places where the food is imported from somewhere else. If you look at your diet, and if you go to the shop and buy cheese and bread and meat, you can see that it's coming from somewhere else. But in cities and municipalities, the waste treatment is in much higher level in Finland than it is in farms. Well, that's about agriculture. We had a big project around the Baltic Sea where we collected the existing know-how about how manure should be treated. And now I have to learn how to point. Oh, this is the way to point. And we found out that it's about circular economy again. So it's about animal feed, first of all, how you feed them. That means how much they have nutrients in their feces. It's about housing, how you collect, how you control the amount of the manure. It's about processing. It's about storage, how much you make environmental problems in the storage phase. And it's very much about soil and field application. And in that project, we gave a lot of advice for farmers, for policymakers, and for industries to make better progress in this field. Of course, the problems are same all over Europe. And the point, the word is refine. I will have another word in the next slide. I don't know if it will be an English word, but you will find out how to refine the biomasses to new products. This is the good background. I'm not going into that because we are in a hurry. The industrial symbiosis is a fuzzy word which is very much used nowadays. So the idea that my waste is your resource and you make business out of it. How to make this cooperation happen when individual firms are facing the economic crisis in all countries in the world? How to make the business opportunities to happen, and how to take this, which was spoken in the Commission presentation a few minutes ago. It's not actually a research challenge anymore. This is the way how Luke looks like, the circular economy. And I will also skip that because that has been presented before. There is several examples. This example is from overseas, but we have some emerging examples also in Finland where we have this industrial symbiosis and your waste is my resource and so on and so forth. Examples which are emerging. But when they are emerging, they find out that one of the entrepreneurs need to face the Ministry of Environment rules, the other one needs to obey the Ministry of Agriculture and Forestry rules, and the third one will have to go and see the Ministry of Industry and so on. So all these actors maybe face different regulation even in the same one country, or even they will face different interpretation of the same rules at least. There is an example of biogas technology, which is a real one, because in biogas technology, Luke, or one of its ancestors, was a pioneer research institute in Finland. And we found out that there were small companies who were developing this business, and we found out that there is research money available. We are very smart to find out that in a research institute. But we also found out that the Finnish Food Agency was not very well aware of this biogas business. So what we found out is that it was very difficult for the small company to deal with the regulations which were composed based on composting of biowaste. So the safety regulations and all kind of mature indicators were applied from composting and not biogas. So what was the role of a research institute? We invented a project where we invited the company, the food safety agency, and other relevant actors into one project. And while that project, also the regulations were developed in such a way that there grow some kind of understanding between the SMEs and the authorities. I was exaggerating, of course, so the Finnish Food Agency made excellent work and so did the SME, but the understanding was sort of missing. But the little company didn't have much money to fight with a faceless bureaucrat institute. Lucky we were that the Finnish Agency for Innovation gave us some money to lubricate that conflict. Another example is separation technology. There is another SME company in Finland with which we were working at Luke several years, and we have developed together a process based on microbiological and chemical processes where we can first take smell out of animal sludge. You can imagine how it smells when you go into big house or a cow house and smell that stuff which is raw. And this technology takes the smell out completely. In addition, it can take phosphorus and nitrogen in different fractions. Much more better than other kinds of separation technologies. The bad thing with this technology is that it's quite costly. And when the market system doesn't play, because this is costly, it's much more easier to just spread it out as long as the legislation is available to do so. There is no difficult to come into market with this kind of technology. And somebody asked from the audience that who is paying for new technologies. I don't know, but I know that the children and grandchildren are paying for the technologies that we are not taking into use. This is just an example that if we have a separation technology which is advanced enough, there is a huge difference between the application area which is needed for the farmer. So this is a big pork production industry, and this is just an example. But if you obey the Finnish rules based on EU regulations, you need 1,500 hectares to spread the raw sludge. But if you are smart enough to make products so that nitrogen goes into liquids and phosphorus goes into the solid fractions, you are below 200 hectares for the solid factors and you are below 200 hectares for the nitrogen factor. So it's enormous change of hectares needed to work in a very short period where you can apply in the fields. So to conclude, there are plenty of technologies and there are plenty of technologies in the pipeline coming, and this public-private R&D cooperation is very efficient to produce those new technologies. The other point is that these pioneer companies, they have lack of resources, know-how, and they even have maybe not anymore so much, but in the past they have problems with acceptability. So I gave you the example a few minutes ago. Of course, there is not much money, but there is a lot of place for new innovative firms, and there is place for these smart business developers, which are not engineers. And then the acceptance of these recyclers nutrients. We are talking about shit, and shit is dirty. And this is the word that I invented. I don't know if this is English, but I don't even know how to pronounce it, but this shit needs to be developed into usable granulates or liquids. Safety, sustainability, economy, usability, image and reputation. They are not. Some of them are research challenges partly, but mostly it's something else. And these incentives are needed so that our grandchildren and the rest do not need to pay for things we didn't do. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Markku. Are there any questions for Markku? Any comments? Yes, there's one here.
Again, Ludwig, how do you get to these high nutrient concentrations with this technology that you presented?
You have to contact the Pellon Group. At least they have a paper in the corridor. I'm not sure if the company is present here. But mainly there is things that are applied from the industrial sewage treatment plants technologies which are applied to manure treatment.
Pellon Group has a paper on the table when you go outside the room. I don't think we have anyone from Pellon Group here today. We had somebody from yesterday, but I can give you the contact information and you'll find out more from the internet web page. Okay, if that is all, thank you, Markku. Oh, there's one more question.
Yes, hello, I'm Eija Hagelberg from Baltic Sea Action Group, and I just would like to say that it's a brilliant idea to put the different stakeholders into the same project and solve the problems there. So if there are some challenges, I think that's something we should do in everything we are doing, like not to be just with the people who maybe think the same way, but also all the time try to get the solutions from other stakeholders.
Thank you. I was a little hesitant to take this example on board here, and I'm sure that my colleague from Food Safety Agency will call me afternoon.